So, good morning once again, and today we are going to cover all ICH guideline overview. Okay, so ICH is very important when you are working in pharma industry. Okay, without ICH and ICH guidances, we cannot perform our duty honestly, and you know, by sticking at the guidelines, the GMP, you name it, we have all the guidelines, right from the stability, GMP specifications, pharmaceutical development, quality risk management, you know, the analytical method development, then validation. So everything is described under the ICH guidelines. Okay. So you will find all the ICH guidelines available freely on ICH.org.com. And ICH is nothing but the International Council for Harmonization of Technical Requirements for Pharmaceutical for Human Use, and is an initiative that brings together regulatory authorities and pharmaceutical industry to discuss scientific and technical aspects of pharmaceutical product development and registration. And since its inception from 1990, you know, ICH has gradually evolved to respond to the increasingly global phase of the drug development. Okay, so, you know, before ICH, before 1990s, the people, the industry used to follow their own guidances or, you know, whatever guidances available in the market, they used to follow them and register their products. So there was no uniformity, there was no harmonization in the technical content or any matter. Like suppose if you want to validate any analytical method, there was no source, you know, there was no guidance. As now you could see ICH Q2 has developed so nicely, so that each pharmaceutical company follow the ICH Q2 for validation of their analytical method. If they want to perform stability, they follow ICH Q1, right? So there are a couple of guidances already published from ICH Q1 to Q14. And that is why the harmonization plays a very important role. What harmonization? In the with respect of technical requirement of pharmaceutical for human use. Okay. And it was a mission worldwide. You know, ICH mission was to ensure that safe, effective and high quality medicines are developed and registered in most resource efficient manner. So ICH, on the 23rd October 2015, ICH announced organizational changes as it makes 25 years of successful harmonization. Okay. So why there was a need to harmonize? Okay. So for most of the countries, whether or not they had initiated product registration controls, earlier the 1960s and 1970s saw a rapid increase in laws, regulation and guidelines for reporting and evaluating the data on safety, quality and efficacy. Correct? So the industry at that time was becoming more international and seeking new global markets. However, the divergence in technical requirements from country to country was such that industry found it necessary to duplicate many time-consuming and expensive test procedures in order to make market new product international. Okay, so everybody wanted to export their product internationally because consider India. Like after India, the company like Cipla, Sun Pharma, Ipca, Ocard, Ranbaxy, or any other company, you name it, top 10 companies would like to enter or export their product to US, FDA, Europe, Canada, you know, and the rest of the world. And that's how there was a need for this harmonization. Because whenever you want to register your product as per country-specific requirement, you have to follow their rules and regulation, country-specific rule regulation and the product-specific specifications, test procedure, correct? But apart from that, during manufacture, what are the requirements to follow GMP? During validation, what are the criteria to follow the validation? You know, right from linearity, specificity, LOD, LOQ. So how those guidances are evolved, you know, during those years, and played an important role in harmonizing everything in our pharma industry. So our harmonization for the regulatory requirement were pioneered by EC Europe in the 1980s, as EC is European Commission. Okay, So Europe moved towards the development of a single market for pharmaceutical, and the success achieved in Europe demonstrated that harmonization was feasible. At the same time, there was a discussion between Europe, Japan, and US. Okay, so there is a possibility of harmonization, and we can, you know, move forward with the forming a tripartite organization and form a ICH, which will be much useful in Europe, US, and Japan. Okay, so it was, however, at the, you know, WHO conference of regulatory authorities in Paris in 1989, the specific plan of action began to materialize. So when it was began in 1989, but the harmonization of regulatory requirement pioneered since 1980. Okay, and soon afterwards, the authorities approached International Federation of Pharmaceutical and Manufacturers and Association, that is IFPMA, IPMA, okay, to discuss joint regulatory industry initiative on international harmonization, and ICH was conceived. Understood. So the birth of ICH took place in April 1990, hosted by EFPIA in the Brussels. Okay. So the representative of regulatory agencies and industry associations of Europe, Japan, and US met primarily to plan an international council, but the meeting also discussed the wider implication in terms of reference of ICH. So at the first ICH steering committee meeting, what happened? ICH terms of reference were agreed, and it was decided that topics selected for harmonization was divided into safety, quality, and efficacy. Correct? So these are the main parameters on which the whole pharmaceutical industry relies upon. Correct? These are the three main criteria for the, you know, basis for approving and authorizing new medicinal product. So who are the ICH member? One is European Commission, EC, US FDA, Ministry of Health, Labor and Welfare, Japan, that is MHLW, and the PMDA from the Japan. Health Canada, Swiss Medic, then ANVISA, Brazil, and MFDS, that is Republic of Korea, Ministry of Food and Drug Safety. And who are the industry members? That is EFPIA, JPMA, IGBA, PHRMA. You can see the full form given. Then the World Self-Medication Industry, WSMI, and BIO, that is Biotechnology Innovation Organization. And who are the observers? Observers are the International Federation of Pharmaceutical Manufacturers and Associations, that is IFMA, and the WHO. Then observer from the India is what? CDSCO. Then there are CECMED Cuba. Then you can see COPEPRIS Mexico, HSA Singapore. So there are many observers, you know, not only observer, we all follow the ICH, you know, guidelines. Observer means we observe all the guidelines and follow in our industry, in your day-to-day life. Okay, so apart from those four or five, there are some more observers like Russia, South Africa, TGA, APEC, ASEAN, GCC, and all. Then Pan American, you know, EPIC is an active pharmaceutical ingredient committee. So you can see there are so many people, even USP, who writes the USP, you know, those are also the observer. EDQM and USP, you must have reading EP and USP, our IP. So all those are observer of ICH. So how the governance of ICH look like? So this is a ICH association. There is an assembly, okay? There is a management committee, ICH secretariat, and the MEDRA management committee, okay? So under ICH secretariat, as I said, ICH is broadly divided into quality, safety, efficacy, and multidisciplinary. Okay? And how this harmonization process takes place? They select for the new topic for harmonization. Then the consensus on draft technical. The first draft is released. That is a step one. Okay. Then the endorsement by the assembly. Okay. You have seen the assembly, right? So assembly, in that management committee, ICS secretariat and Mentra management committee. So when the first draft is drafted, it goes for the endorsement by the assembly. Then the regulatory consultation and discussion happens and the assembly adopt the ICH guideline. Okay. And then the implementation, then the, those ICH guidelines are published. Correct. So these are the simple step one to step five. This is the harmonization process. Okay. Now we look into the overview of ICH topic, that is quality, safety, efficacy, and multidisciplinary. Okay. So under quality, you are already aware of, familiar, I would say, about the stability, right? So Q1, again, Q1 is divided into, you can see Q1A, Q1B, C, D, E, F. Okay. So each guideline is important when you talk about stability testing for drug substance and drug product. You talk about photostability testing of new drug substance, stability testing for new dosage form, bracketing matrixing, Q1D, then evaluation of stability data, Q1E, then Q1F talks about the stability data package for registration application in climatic zone 3 and 4. So it's very interesting, you know, to have such a beautiful guidelines for each different topic under the stability, ICH Q1. Okay. Then Q2 talks about the validation of analytical procedure, that is Q2R1. So Q2R2, Q14, just see analytical procedure development and revision of Q2R1 analytical validation. So based on this Q2R1, then Q14 is also evolved, you know, the recently, like 2 years back. Earlier, it was only Q2 for the validation of analytical procedure. Okay. Then Q3 talks about the impurities in new drug substance, new drug product, then residual solvents, then elemental impurities. This is also very important, Q3D. Then Q3DR2 also came into publish, that is for the cutaneous and transdermal products. And then Q3D talks about the training, that is implementation for guidelines for elemental impurities. Okay, so nowadays, if you see elemental impurities, genotoxic impurities has become a very popular or the hot topic because of nitrosamine impurities. Okay, then Q4, ICH Q4 talks about the pharmacopoeia, correct? So how the pharmacopoeial harmonization takes place, how it was evolved, how the recommendation of pharmacopoeia text and for the use in ICH region. Then Q3B, you can see there are so many annexes are available for the general chapter. You can see the general chapter for sulfate as test, acceptable volume, particulate contamination, microbial examination, DT, DISO, uniformity of dosage, sterility, you know, tablet friability. So many guidances are available. Okay, so you, if you get time, it's really very nice to have knowledge upon all these topics before you enter into industry. This will be really helpful when you actually perform your duty, when you actually employed for the job purpose. Okay, these are the knowledge based program. The skill will be seen when you are actually on duty. Okay. So when you will be skilled yourself when you have the thorough knowledge. When you have knowledge, you practice it. So with practice, you will get skilled. Okay. So that's how this ICH is very helpful. I'm telling you again and again. So if you learn only ICH Q1 to ICH Q14, sky is the limit for your career. Okay. So coming after Q4. ICH Q5 talks about the quality of biotechnological product, and it is again divided into ICH Q5 A, B, C, D, and E. Okay, then Q6 specifications. So specifications for new drug substance and new drug product. Q6 is also divided into A and B. Okay, so A talks about the chemical substance and B talks about the acceptance criteria for biotechnological and biological products. Correct? Then Q7, last week, if you recollect, we have discussed about the good manufacturing practices. Q8 talks about the pharmaceutical development. Okay. Q9, quality risk management. Q10, pharmaceutical quality system. Q11 is a development and manufacture of drug substance. Okay. QBD, you might have heard about. Then Q12, life cycle management. Then Q13, continuous manufacturing of drug substance and drug product. And Q14, it's analytical procedure development. So Q2 is analytical method validation, and this is analytical procedure development, Q14. So easy to remember ICH Q1 to Q14. And please spend time to read all those guidelines. Those are very important. And after reading this, I will just browse through for you guys, because everything is available online, and even I am going to share this PPT with you. So you can read it whenever you find time. This is very important. So here, what I captured all the information, to give an overview of each guideline, like ICH Q1 R2 stability testing for new drug substance and the products. What is the objective of guideline? What is the note? What is the purpose of stability testing? Is, you know, so everything is given in short. You know, so in short means the purpose of ICH Q1A R2 stability testing is what? To provide evidence how quality varies with time under the influence of temperature, humidity, and light. So you know how to perform the stability studies with the different temperature and humidity and at different time intervals, like 0 months, 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, you know, 1 year till your shelf life. Then retest period, correct? So the period after which samples of the drug substance should be examined to ensure that material is still in compliance with the specification and which could be used for the manufacturing. So retest period should be proposed on the basis of stability results and may be extended for 5 years. Okay. Based on your stability, cumulative stability data, you can extend your shelf life and the retest period. Okay, then establish shelf life of the drug product, that expiry date, expiration, dating period, you can calculate. Okay. Then it gives the test condition based on analysis of effect of climatic condition in 3 regions like US, Europe, and Japan. Right? It gives mean kinetic temperature. So the world is divided into 4 climatic zones, right? Zone 1, 2, 3, 4. So all the information will be available these guidelines. You can see these are the zones. So zone 4 is divided into zone 4A and 4B, right? Hot, humid, tropical, and 4B is like India, falls under this Asian testing condition, hot and higher humidity. Okay. You can see the long-term stability testing condition, the temperature, humidity, and the accelerated condition for the temperature and humidity. Normally, the long-term testing is done for 12 months and the accelerated is done for 6 months. Okay, accelerated is always what? 40, 60 degree minimum, like 40 degrees Celsius plus 60% humidity. But there are different climatic zones. So as per climatic zones, this humidity and the temperature varies, correct? So suppose if it is accelerated ambient condition, then 40 plus minus 2 degree and 75% RH, relative humidity. Okay. So at this different temperature and humidity, you have to keep your sample and study the data for 6 months. Whereas in long-term testing condition, you have to keep under this temperature and humidity condition and study your sample for 12 months. Collect the data for 12 months. Pretty simple. Then ICH Q1B talks about the photostability or testing. It covers studies on test on active substance, test on the exposed product outside of the immediate pack and if necessary, and test on product in the immediate pack and if necessary. Correct? This is for the exposed product outside of immediate pack, and this is on the product in the immediate pack. And test on the product in the marketing plan. Correct? Then Cuban C talks about new dosage form. You can read. Okay. So Q1B talks about photostability. Q1C talks about new dosage form. New dosage form is defined as what? Medicinal product, which is different pharmaceutical product type, but containing the same active substance as included in the existing product approved by the pertinent regulatory authority, which includes product of a different route of administration, new specific function or delivery system, right? Or different dosage form altogether, like capsule to tablet, solution to suspension, like that. Then the stability protocol for new dosage form should follow the guidance in parent stability guideline. New stability database at submission time may be acceptable with proper justification. Next 6 month accelerated and 6 month long term data from ongoing study may be acceptable in certain justified cases. So these are the different stability parameters for different types of dosage form. For tablet, it is appearance, color, odor, assay, disintegration, dissolution, moisture, and friability or hardness testing. For hard gelatin capsule, appearance, color, odor of content, acidity, moisture, microbial limits. Soft gelatin capsule, appearance, color, odor, DT, diso, moisture, microbial limit, pH, leakage, and pellicle formation, because it is a soft gelatin capsule, right? Then emulsions, appearance including phase separation, because emulsion get easily separated, right? So that is why phase separation. Then same as above, color, odor, assay, pH, preservative, viscosity is also very important, weight loss and microbial. For suppositories, again, most of the cases are same, apart from the softening range, you know. Then small volume palatal, that is SVP, LVP. Appearance, color, all other tests common. And particulate matter, sterility and pyrogenicity is very important because it is parenteral. Correct? So in both cases, you will see these three tests are very important. Then transdermals. Then leakage, microbial limit, sterility, peel and adhesive forces, drug release rate. So you should remember all the important tests required for various dosage form. You know? Then Q1D, we have covered Q1C. Q1D talks about the bracketing and matrixing designs for stability testing. Correct? So when there are, you know, number of samples increasing because we have to manufacture three batches, pack into three different packs, you know, keep into different storage condition like temperature, humidity. So if you multiply, you know, even if you consider three batches into three pack, three into three, it is a nine, right? Then you multiply by number of condition, number of months. So at the end of the day, samples taken out will be huge. So analytical load will be huge. So in certain cases, you know, the matrixing and bracketing is allowed, but you should be in a position to justify. Okay. For drug substance, matrixing is limited. Bracketing generally not applicable. So any reduced design should be justified. Type and level of justification depends on available supporting data. So careful consideration and scientific justification in bracketing and matrixing in one design. Okay. So you have to do it very careful so that you can justify to any health authority. Okay, why you have done the bracketing and matrixing. And there should be a scientific justification. Okay. So bracketing is the design of a stability schedule such that only the extremes of certain design factor are tested at all time points, right? Different strain, different container size. Suppose if I have manufactured cetirizine tablet 5 mg, 10 mg, 20 mg. Okay. And I have designed a stability protocol for 0 month, 1 month, 3 month, 6 months, 9 months, 12 months, 18 months. So in that case, you can consider three strength, three batches, three packs, and three conditions. So big, you know, data. So you have, you can design your protocol in such a way that the different strain, different container size and fill, you can take the extremes, you know, only the extremes for certain design factor are tested at all the time point. Okay. So that suppose 5 mg and 20 mg, you can test for all condition, and middle strain, that is, you can, you know, give the waiver to and justify. So that you get all the data and you can scientifically justify towards your packaging and matrixing in front of the health authority. Okay. And then the stability of intermediate level represented by stability or tested extremes. Packaging design not appropriate if tested samples are not the extremes. Okay. Matrixing is the statistical design of stability schedule, and each storage condition should be treated separately under its own matrixing design. So at a given time point, other than the initial or final one, not every batch on stability needs to be tested. Okay. So full testing must be performed at the maximum storage period at the time of submission. So later on, when follow-up stability you have to perform, there you can apply this, you know, matrixing system. So these are the stages for bracketing or matrixing you have to perform, like pre-development stages, preferable bracketing, clinical phases from 1 to 3, bracketing, accelerated and long-term testing with the registration batch, bracketing and matrixing is, you know, preferable. And ongoing, that is, as I said, follow-up stability data, matrixing is allowed. Okay. Then Q1E talks about the evaluation of stability data. It describes how to propose a retest period for the drug substance and a shelf life for drug product in the registration application. And when and how extrapolation beyond available data can be considered. Q1F talks about stability data package for registration application in climatic zone 3 and 4 objectives of the guideline. Okay. Then application for ICH Q1AR in countries of climatic zone 3 and 4. Q1F stability data package for registration application in climatic zone 3 and 4. So ICH steering committee endorsed the withdrawal of this guideline, you know, ICH Q1F. In June 2006, and decided to leave definition of storage condition in climatic zone 3 and 4 to the respective region and WHO. And that is why this ICH Q1F, this guideline withdrawn on 8 June 2006. So in this way, we have covered all the guidelines available under ICH Q1, that is stability. It's a big guidelines, and you are able to read those guidelines, you know, step by step, it will be really good during your career, you know, because these are the guidelines. On this basis only we perform all the stability data and make the registration applications. See, all this data is important when you file ANDA, NDA, or any clinical phase data is given to health authority for the approval. Okay. Into registration and getting marketing approved. Then come to ICQ2, which is again analytical validation procedure. Correct? So all the validation parameters for a variety of analytical method is discussed here. These are the analytical test procedures. Generally, there are identification tests, qualitative tests for impurities contained, limit test for control of impurities, quantitative test for active moiety in samples of drug substance or drug product, typical validation characteristic of analytical procedure, accuracy, precision, you know, then specificity, LOD, LOQ, linearity, range, everything covers under this analytical method validation. Then impurity, Q3A, impurity in new drug substance, correct? So again, impurities are of three types: organic impurities, which is generated during process and the drug related, inorganic impurities, and the residual solvents. So these guidelines specifically deal with those impurities which might arise as degradation product of the drug substance or arising from interaction between the drug substance and the excipient or the component of primary packaging material. Okay, understood. So during stability also, when we keep the samples at various temperature and humidity, there are chances to degradation happens, right? So whenever degradation happens during the stability of the your drug substance or the drug product, so it is also covered under these impurities, okay? Then there is an interaction between excipient and the drug. There are also chances to, you know, so these are already discussed under chapter 3. So impurities in the drug product and drug substance is very important. Okay, and these guidelines sets out a rationale for the reporting, identification and qualification of such impurities based on scientific appraisal. Right. So I hope you understood, guys. Then the threshold value you have to report and control the impurities based on the maximum daily dose. So sometimes, you know, paracetamol is prescribed to take 2 tablets per day. So 250 is a dose, suppose. So you are consuming 500 milligram of dose. So based on your daily dose of drug substance and the drug product administered, you have to calculate the threshold value. Okay. So the identification and the reporting value will be different. So you have to follow that chart. And you have to derive those threshold value and see whether the limit given as per ICH is acceptable or not. Okay. Then we talk about ICH Q3A and Q3D impurities. Okay. So what is the objective of this guideline? The objective is to recommend acceptable amounts of residual solvents in the pharmaceutical for the safety of the patient. Right. So these guidelines recommend use of less toxic solvents. So any health authority's main objective is what? To protect public health. So to protect public health, we are meeting all the guidelines, right? Right from the GMP, GLP, GCP, GDP. And apart from that, what we follow? Tell me what we follow. We see to that all the tests which we are performed is acceptable. It is within the limit. It should not give the toxic solvent. It should not emit any toxic solvent, right? The level or whatever toxicity is derived out of that substance or the product, it should be within acceptable limit. Okay, whatever solvent you must be using during the process, it should be also within limit. It should not carry forward and remain in the product so that it will increase the toxicity level when the drug is consumed by the end user, the patient like us. Okay. So ICH Q3A, the D impurities again divided into what? TDI, ADI and PDE. That is tolerable daily intake and acceptable daily intake and the permitted daily exposure. Okay. So you can read it later on. This definition, then we talk about class 1 solvent, class 2 solvent and class 3 solvent, right? Class 1 means what? Solvent to be avoided. Known human carcinogenic, right? Strongly suspected human carcinogens and environmental hazards. Solvent 2 means solvent to be limited, non-genotoxic animal carcinogen or possible positive agent. Other irreversible toxicity such as neurotoxicity and teratogenicity and solvents suspected of other significant but reversible toxicities. Correct? And solvent 3 is what? Very low toxic. Okay? So it is allowed in our industry. So solvent with low toxic potential, solvent with low toxic potential to man, no health-based exposure limit is needed. So class 3 solvent have PDE of 50 milligram or more per day. Then Q3D elemental impurities. So you might have heard the story of Maggie, right? The lead content was very high. That's why Maggie was banned from the Nestle. And that is why it has become very popular, you know. In our day-to-day life also, we are consuming lots of medicine and we don't know how much elemental impurities going into your body, right? Which may be toxic in later stage of your life, which may cause cancer and other, you know, disease. So that is why this elemental impurities is very important, how you monitor, how you take care of all the risk assessment, you know. So the objective of this guideline is to develop global policy for limiting elemental impurities in your drug products, right? It is harmonized safety-based limits for elemental impurities, especially those of highest toxicological concern. So the selection of elements to control, methodology for establishing safety-based limits, and permitted daily exposure for specific elements. These are the three objectives. And appropriate risk-based approach, right? The risk-based approach means risk management plan should be in place to ensure control for elements likely to be present in the drug product and the ingredients. Then Q4A talks about the pharmacopeial harmonization. Okay, the pharmacopeial authorities working together through pharmacopeial discussion group, that is PDG, have been closely involved with the work of ICH since the harmonization started, right, in 1989. So ICH steering committee receives regular reports on the status of pharmacopeial harmonization at its meetings. So how it is evolved, the evaluation and recommendation of pharmacopeial text for the use in ICH region. You can read this. Then what are the steps in the ICH process, right? So there are step 1, step 2, step 3, step 4, step 5. We have seen this in brief in the flowchart earlier. Then come to ICH Q5. Q5 is again divided into Q5A2, Q5E. That talks about viral safety evaluation of biotech products. Correct? Then the quality of biotech products. You can see analysis of the expression construct in cells used for the rDNA. Q5C, quality of biotech products, stability testing. Q5D, derivation and characterization of cell substrates used for production of biotech and biological products. Q5E, comparability of biotechnological biological products subject to changes in their manufacturing process. Okay. Q6, specification for new drug substance and the drug product. So all the test procedure and the specification you would see have the acceptance criteria, correct? Without acceptance criteria, you cannot test also. Suppose I will give one example of DT. It should be disintegrate, you know, within 5 minutes or 10 minutes. So when you design the experiment, you perform all the studies during your formulation, pre-formulation studies, that becomes your acceptance criteria. When you go for ANDA, you check for the innovators, right? The innovators, how it is performing, the DISO, DT, and all in vivo, in vitro correlation, you have to check. So all tests, whether it is a disintegration, dissolution, friability, hardness, every test has the limit. So all appropriate analytical procedure, all references has the acceptance criteria, okay, which is in numerical limits or the range. Generally, hardness is given in the range, you know, 15 Newton to 50 Newton, like hardness, friability. Then you can see DISO, okay, dissolved within 45 minutes. Of what, then Q value is given. If you see the USP monograph, you can see how the limit acceptance criteria is given in the numerical limits or the range. Okay, so this ICH Q6 defines, you know, all the specifications for the test procedure and the acceptance criteria, which play a major role in assuring the quality of your new drug substance in the new drug product during shelving. Then there are some universal tests, okay, like description, identification, assay, and impurities. Correct? And there are specific tests for the drug substance like physicochemical properties, particle size, polymorphic form, chiral new drug substance, water content, inorganic impurities, microbial limits. And there are a couple of others like specific tests for drug products. That is OSD, oral solid dosage. Okay. PSD, DISO, DT, hardness, uniformity of content, microbial limit. And there are so many others. Then the specific test for drug product, that is parenteral. We have seen this oral dosage. Now these are the parenteral. Okay. Then Q6B talks about test procedure and acceptance criteria for biotech product. So example of procedure used to measure biological activity include what? Animal-based biological assay, which measures an organism's biological response to the product. Cell culture-based biological assay, which measures biochemical or physiological response at the cellular level. Correct? And biochemical assays, which measure biological activity such as enzymatic reaction rates or the biological responses included by immunological interaction. So now all the vaccines, serum, which are manufactured comes under a biological product, which requires they follow this ICH-Q6. Then talk about Q7. It's very popular guideline. It talks about the GMP. Correct. GMP always start from, personal, building, facility, process, equipment, documentation, record. Then Q8 talks about the product development, pharmaceutical product development. Okay, how you design your quality of the product, manufacture, process, so that it remains consistent. Okay? It consistently deliver the intended performance of the product. It also describes what type of dosage form and formulation that are suitable for intended use. ICH-Q8 gives information about drug substance, excipient, container closure system. The aim of this pharmaceutical development is to what? Design quality product and its manufacturing process to consistently deliver an intended performance of the product. Then Q9 talks about quality risk management, right? So wherever you go, there is a risk, right? Now during COVID also, the people who have vaccinated still gets the COVID positive report, correct? Those who have completed two doses also as affected with the COVID infection. So everywhere there is a risk. When you go walk on the road, you have to see, left and right whether vehicle is coming or, you have to follow the signals when you are crossing the roads. So everywhere is a risk. So how the risk is managed, risk is assessed, risk is identified, that is, given under this quality risk management guide. You have to evaluate the risk of quality, and it should be based on your scientific knowledge and ultimately linked to the protection of the patient. And the level of effort and documentation of the quality risk management process should be commensurate with the level of risk. Right? So this, again, Q10 talks about the pharmaceutical quality system. Right? It describes the model for an effective quality management system for the pharmaceutical industry, referred to as pharmaceutical quality system. Q11 talks about QPD, which is again, this is a new guidance proposed for active pharmaceutical ingredient, harmonizing the scientific and technical principles relating to the description and justification of development and manufacturing process. Right? It's given under CTD topic. The goal of this process is what? To establish a commercial manufacturing process capable of consistently producing drug substance of the intended quality. Q12 talks about what? Product lifecycle management. Okay? Because once you register your product, it should remain in the market, yours and yours. You can see many brands, those are available, yours and yours, right? Procine is a big brand. Then there are so many, you know, the atorvastatin, then glycodine, then look at the calcium sandoz, and so many varieties of products. Those are years and years. So you have to keep monitoring the changes happening to that drug, the CMC relevant changes. The CMC means chemistry, manufacturing, and control changes. Okay. And you have to keep watch in an efficient and the predictable manner so that you capture the changes, submit the annual update to health authority, and you maintain that license. Okay. So once you get the license, it is applicable or valid for the 5 years. And each 5 year, you have to renew those license so that you maintain your products with the same quality with consistent result for years and years, right? So this adoption of this new ICH guideline will promote innovation and continual improvement and strengthen quality assurance and reliable supply of product, including proactive planning of supply chain adjustments, right? So it will allow regulators, that is assessor and inspectors, to better understand the firm's pharmaceutical quality system or management of post-approval CMC changes. Okay. So this new guideline is intended to complement the existing ICH Q8 to Q11 guideline and includes a core guideline as well as annexes. Then Q13 talks about the continuous manufacturing of drug substance and the drug product. Okay. This is also new guideline published in June 8, 2018. And this guideline is proposed to capture what key technical and regulatory consideration that promote harmonization, including certain GMP practices, okay, specific to continuous manufacturing. It also allows drug manufacturer to employ flexible approaches to develop, implement, or integrate continuous manufacturing for the manufactured drug substance and drug product, small molecule and the therapeutic protein for new and existing product. Provide guidance to industry and the regulatory agencies regarding regulatory expectations on the development, implementation, and assessment of continuous manufacturing technologies used in the manufacture of drug substance and the drug product. Then the last guidelines, that is Q14, which helps, right, which help guide you what analytical procedure development. And this is also published in June 2018. Earlier it was, I said, Q2R2, which talks about analytical method validation, right? And it was revised. Like the scope of revision of ICH Q2R1 will include validation principle that cover analytical use of spectroscopic or spectrometry data. Okay, like NIR, Raman, NMR, or MS, some of which often require multivariate statistic analysis. Right, and this new guideline proposed to harmonize the scientific approaches of analytical procedure development and to provide the principle relating to the description of analytical procedure development process. This new guideline is intended to improve regulatory communication between industry and regulators and facilitate more efficient, sound, specific, sound scientific and risk-based approval as well as post-approval change management of analytical procedure. And these are the references from where I gathered all the content for you. And that's all about the ICH guideline and all ICH quality guideline we have described from Q1, 2, 3, 4 to Q14. Okay. And if you have any question, we will discuss further. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you, ma'am.